Ethernet I/O makes connecting up to 16 slave devices quick and simple. And those 16 devices can be any combination of GSE drives, EBC-100s, or Terminator EBCs, which gives you a whole bunch of I/O options. And the good news is, all of those thousands of I/Os appear to your ladder program like simple local I/O, which makes your job easy. For this video, we have a Do More base, an EBC-100-205 base, a Terminator I/O EBC-100, and a GSE drive 100 connected to a GS series VFD, all wired via Ethernet through a Stride 8-port Ethernet switch. We use NetEdit to configure all the IP addresses and update the firmware on all of these units. Don't forget to do that. To use Ethernet I/O with any of these devices, you need to make sure they all have the most recent firmware, which you can always download for free from the Automation Direct website, so no excuses, right? To enable Ethernet I/O, you just go to the system configuration and check this box right here. The Do More is now an Ethernet I/O master, and you see it as a new hardware item in the tree over here. To add a slave device, you just click on that guy. Now, if you're online with your system, the best way to set up slaves is to simply auto-detect them by hitting this button right here. You automatically get a list of all the devices right here in this dialog, and all you have to do is click on the ones you want to add. I'll go ahead and add all three. Again, you can see the 205 base with an EBC-100, you can see the Terminator I/O, and you can see the GS drive. Note that you can set up and change the IP addresses of the master right here and the slaves right here. You can also just double click on a slave to change it. Let's go ahead and change this DS drive name that's all messed up. And the IP address is fine. Either way you access this dialog, one thing you definitely want to keep an eye on is this poll rate. A zero says poll as fast as you can. So if all devices are polling as fast as possible, this Ethernet I/O feature has the potential to consume every bit of bandwidth available, which may be okay for your setup, but for me, I like to limit these to something reasonable so I have bandwidth available for other things I might want to use the Ethernet port for, like see more micro HMIs and things. So I'm going to change all of the polling times to about 4 times a second on these units. That's plenty fast for what I want to do. By the way, while I'm thinking about it, there's a new utility that allows you to monitor and optimize Ethernet traffic. It's called the Ethernet I/O Monitor Utility. There's a whole separate video on that one, so don't forget to check it out. It's a real lifesaver when you're trying to debug issues on your Ethernet traffic. Now, in this dialog, you can also tell the CPU what to do if the slave has an error. If you tell the CPU to stay in run mode, even if the slave has an error, then you get another option that says, do you want the slave to be online when the CPU enters run mode? And one nice feature I like is that when the slave has an error, what do you want its inputs to do? Me, I like for them to hold their last state so that I can see exactly what the system was seeing when things crashed. Great, all of our IP addresses are all set up, and we've changed the poll rates on all of our devices to just 4 times a second to help minimize the impact on Ethernet bandwidth. Over here in the hardware tree, we see all the new hardware, and if we click on this I/O configuration level, we actually see pictures of the hardware that we auto-detected. You can see individual hardware items by clicking on these guys right here. I know that I'm using a 4-slot base, so I'll go ahead and adjust that here. Great. If you click on I/O mappings, you can see how each unit is mapped in memory. Here's our Do More base, and here's the Ethernet I/O master, and everything that's connected via Ethernet I/O. Here's my 205 base, my Terminator I/O, and my GS drive. And look at this 205 base. All of the addressing of all the I/Os, they look just like local I/O, don't they? And they're assigned just like local I/O. So your ladder program won't know the difference, and that makes your programming effort a whole lot easier. Now, the only problem with this is, what if I add another I/O module back in the base down here? And suppose he's got some inputs and some outputs. Well, if auto mapping is selected, then those guys will be assigned the next addresses, and it'll bump all these up to the next available address. And that can really mess up your ladder code. So it's a good idea to get in the habit of leaving some addressing space between the bases. So I'm going to right-click on this 205 base, and I'm going to have his inputs start at address 200, and his outputs start at address 200. That does two things. One, I can now install as many modules here as I want, and as it automatically assigns the addresses, it won't impact the addressing of my slave devices. And the other thing I kind of like about this is it puts each slave on a different addressing boundary. It just helps me keep track of which IOs go to which slave device. So let's say we put the 205 base at 200. Let's go ahead and put the Terminator IO. I'm going to right click at 400. Again, that gives me plenty of room to expand things later. The GS drive down here doesn't have any addressing. It has its own unique data structure. There's a separate video showing how to use that, but know that for the most part, you access the parameters of the drive using the same dot notation just like any other do more data structure. That makes working with GS drives a breeze. Now if I want to add a module to one of these 205 bases, well that's easy, right? Just come up here, right click on the module you want to change, you can delete it and add a new one if you want to. Especially on bases that have empty slots like this. But what do you do on a Terminator IO? It doesn't have slots to drop new modules into. Well, look at this. All you do is drag the cursor to between the two modules and you get this little hotspot here. You right click on the hotspot and add a module. Easy. Well, we've covered a lot of details here, but the bottom line for Ethernet IO is simple. You just enable the feature here under CPU configuration by checking that box, then click on that IO master, and then auto detect all of your hardware in the system by clicking on this button right here. Once you've done that, you'll probably want to go down to IO mappings and put an offset on all your slaves to allow for future expansion. That's really all there is to setting up the Ethernet IO to get quick and easy access to thousands of IOs. Once you're done, hit OK. You get the standard warning saying, hey, things have changed, and you need to make sure the PLC is in program mode in order to make those changes. Yeah, we know that. Well, let's go ahead and download this to the DoMore and try it out. Now to show you this is working, I'll just bring up a data view. And let's see, if I bring up the system IO monitor and undock that so it's easier to see, this gives me a fantastic view of all of my hardware. Here's my local base, here's my Ethernet IO master, and here are the three slaves that I have under that master. The beauty of this is at a glance, I can see what all my addressing is. So let's see, the 205 base has outputs starting at Y200. So let's go ahead and put a Y200 in here so we can mess around with that one. And if I hit Control Enter, it automatically increments this. We'll do a couple of those. And we have some outputs on our Terminator IO. They start at Y400, so I'll add a couple of those down here. We'll turn on editing. We are in run mode, so we're ready to go. If I simply double click on one of these, and no, I don't want you to ask me that again. Sure enough, the light on the module lit up to tell me that that output's active. If I try one of the Terminator IO ones, sure enough, that one lights up. That's it. For all practical purposes, to your ladder program, all of these IOs that are connected via Ethernet IO, they're just local IO. And that makes your programming effort so easy. By the way, a little side note here. Did you notice in this IO system view, if you click on any of these modules, look at this. All the documentation for that module is right at your fingertips. And any status for that module is displayed here also. If there was an error, this would be lit up red. You click on it and you would see exactly what you need to do to fix that. And the best part of all this Ethernet IO stuff is that the configuration for all of these slave devices is stored in the DoMore. So if you swap out any module anywhere in the entire Ethernet IO network, you don't have to manually reconfigure it or write any ladder code to initialize it. Just drop it in and then DoMore automatically configures that module for you. Well, that ought to be enough to get you started with the Ethernet IO on the DoMore. Be sure to check out the other videos in this series for more tips on using the DoMore PLC. And don't forget, Automation Direct's tech support is always free, and you will talk to a real live person here in the US within minutes. You got a question? You can call, email, or even do online chat, whatever you prefer. Spend less, do more from Automation Direct.